Good afternoon. My name is David Owens. I'm head of technical trials at Telefonica. And today I'm going to talk to you about enabling a 5G future. So when we think about 5G, 5G is the next step in the evolution of mobile technology. We know that national 5G infrastructure, when it arrives in a few years' time, will make a contribution, an additional contribution of 7 billion a year to the UK economy in just 6 years after rollout. It will be a technology breakthrough that will allow a profound and gradual transformation of industry and society. However, we must consider that 5G to be more than just pure connectivity. It has the potential to transform every sector it touches, from transport to energy grids, from manufacturing to social and healthcare, and from education to entertainment. Just spending a moment introducing Telefonica. Telefonica is a company that operates in 14 countries worldwide, and we offer services to 100 services in 170 countries through other partnerships. We also have extremely large fiber networks in Europe and Latin America, serving 320 million customers worldwide. And 34 million of those in the UK. The biggest opportunity for 5G isn't what we do for our customers today. It's how we transform businesses, utilities, and companies and critical infrastructure in the future. And that's why we've been working with businesses across all sectors to explore how they can make the best use of 5G so we can bring customer-led solutions to the market for each sector. And our work with DCMS on the government projects has really helped inform our view in this space. We believe that helping businesses become more efficient, it will help them protect revenue and growth. We also believe that it will help employees by mobilizing and empowering the workforce, safeguarding and protecting them wherever they are. From a customer perspective, it will help serve them new interactive, immersive services, which will have greater personalization. 5G comes with three technologies: EMBB, URLLC, and MMTC. Just taking each one of those in turn briefly, EMBB will provide what we called unlimited experiences. This is AR and VR virtual reality experiences and immersive video. URLLC is probably the most exciting of the new technologies and will help deliver great functionality around networks of networks, mobile edge computing, network slicing, and private networks. And finally, massive machine type communication, which is IoT for everything. It will allow us to connect thousands of devices rather than hundreds that's been possible today to enhance that machine type communication service that we offer today. 5G NR has five key technology components. The first and most probably important is the new spectrum, but not at any cost. Massive MIMO and beamforming helps us increase speed and improve capacity. And then if we think about the next generation core network, it improves services by protecting vital services and allowing us to provide quality of service around critical communications with services such as network slicing. We need to ensure that it has coexistence with existing services in the past. So services like LTE need to be supported because we can't have a rip and replace strategy. Technology, once deployed, needs to provide service for maybe up to 10 years. And then finally, cloud optimization, which focuses on software-defined networks, network function virtualization, and software-defined radio, helps us provide dynamic network services and flexible services. Going back to the capabilities that I have covered in the earlier slides, the first benefit we will see will be around greater capacity and speed offered by EMBB. And this will help enhance the current use cases, particularly around data transfer, AR and VR, and HD video, providing speeds between 8 and 10 times faster, and low latency speeds, which are 10 times faster than before. This will particularly help the gaming industry, with companies like Stadia and xCloud benefiting from this. It will support immersive AR remote experts and VR for training and create new staff and customer experiences. Ultra-reliable, low-latency communication will open up a whole new range of new use cases, particularly around Industry 4.0, with significant benefits to manufacturing. It comes with carrier-grade security, mobile edge compute to allow you to bring the internet closer to the edge to support fast processing of data and allow businesses to act on that information quickly with latency within 1 millisecond. High resilience, long-term network of networks will allow private networks to seamlessly hand over between Wi-Fi, cellular and satellite, as well as private networks and software-defined networks. Network slicing will give you dedicated bandwidth, which will be critical for automation of critical applications and services. Whilst I'm sure many of your businesses already have or are planning to use IoT, 5G IoT is very much in its infancy, and today the real backbone of the IoT industry is the enhanced machine-type communication of 4G. Massive machine-type communication, however, will enable for the first time large-scale IoT. When everything gets connected, we can instrument our world, and this will allow us to understand pollution and traffic congestion and many other things in much greater detail. MMTC has the ability to connect thousands of devices with faster data rates and lower latency. This will have impacts on many sectors, and if we think about cities and towns of the future, this will enable traffic control, intelligent traffic systems and platforms, environmental monitoring and connected internet of bins, for example. In stores of the future, monitoring goods right the way through the supply chain, from the shelves, the trolleys, serving this information to staff and customers is also needed. Health, there will be a large-scale deployment of trackers and sensors for acute and chronic conditions, which will allow for assisted living and communication between patients and doctors and smart ambulances, improving patient care and outcomes. And for every sector, it is likely to have a significant impact in connecting businesses to their assets and people, enabling them to make decisions faster and drive automation and efficiencies. With all of this additional network, we need to make sure that we're committed to the green agenda. And I can happily say that O2 is committed to being green. In practical terms, we want to be blue by 2025, and that means net zero. And we want to see a 30% reduction in our supply chain in the next 5 years too. And starting this year, we're on a mission to save energy wherever we can. And we estimate that we can save 6 million kilowatt hours of previously wasted electricity through network power. To put that into context, the UK today has a peak capacity of around 75 gigawatts of generating capacity and an average demand of around 35 gigawatts. So for us, by snoozing some of our capacity layers between the hours of 11 p.m. and 6 a.m, we can reduce the amount of energy our network uses. We also believe that we can further improve in two further areas, both in travel and domestic living, which are the two highest uses of carbon today. By reducing travel through improved networking and conferencing facilities, it allows people to work effectively from home. And this even includes estimates based on the rebound effect, where people would then use more carbon at home compared to the carbon that they would have used in the office. And our smart meter program will help customers save energy at home by making them aware of the energy usage and allow them to reduce as required. We believe that this will save up to 43 megatons of CO2 a year. And it's worth just mentioning that O2 is also championed recycling devices with our O2 Recycle program, which is an award-winning device recycling program. Just would like to pause for a moment to talk about standards. Standards make it very easy for interconnection between different types of networks and provide interoperability over networks, enabling free movement of trade and equipment and devices. When we think about our standards with 5G, it is quite a complicated web, and it is really important that we support the Standards Institutes when we think about our 5G networks. The ITU sets out the timeline. 5GPPP has done a great job in disseminating key messages on 5G, and 3GPP is really where the standards get built. Moving on to coverage then, and ubiquity. When I think about the UK landmass, the UK landmass is something like 240,000 square kilometres. The population lives in a very small proportion of that area. And when we look at the challenges that we face providing coverage for the whole of that area, where 100% coverage, you know, is our eventual goal, I see three areas of concern. And we will need a wide range of solutions from neutral host to additional spectrum to help deliver in this. So if I go through each of the areas in turn, looking at planning, regulation in dense urban and suburban areas, we need to improve. Need to be improved or relaxed, specifically focusing on PPGA, the GPDO, and the National Planning Policy Framework. Then turning to in-building coverage, or in-building solutions as I like to refer to them, the IBS of mobile networks. This is a really big problem. And with 5G frequencies not providing good coverage into internal spaces from external locations, we will really have to focus on how we provide in-building coverage. Looking at the industry, there are 6 million SMEs, and this means that it's a sizable problem and probably will mean that we'll need Wi-Fi for the foreseeable future, as it will play a big role in indoor space. Then finally, looking at rural networks, we will need a combination of terrestrial and extraterrestrial networks to fully serve the population and to get to that last, you know, 0.1%. And this means that we'll need to integrate with satellite communication systems into our mobile networks. I am heartened to see the great work that SpaceX and OneWeb are doing here, especially now with their Starlink constellation, which has a significant number of satellites in it, approaching 900. Also, the work on Wi-Fi on 802.11 and 802.15 is really important too. And the great work that's been done in Leeds University on the terabyte optical wireless solutions by Professor Jeffrey Emeghani on the terabyte speed and ultra capacity indoor networks. And also Professor Harold Haas, who continues to focus on Wi-Fi and the 6G Wi-Fi, Li-Fi, I should say, light Fi solutions and edge compute. The insatiable demand for data, which we expect to continue into the future, as we see services around HDR video and 8K immersive video services introduced, really challenges our network. And really that's in two areas. First of all, today, the cost of our networks are directly proportional to the number of sites that we deliver. And for 5G, we're predicting that we'll need between 5 and 10 times as many as we have today. So we will need to improve that technology. And then we would hope that improvements in technology, large scale integration and Moore's law will help us with that regard. And we would hope to see the price of base stations coming down towards that we would pay for Wi-Fi hotspots today in the future. Thinking then finally about spectrum. Spectrum is really important for us because it allows us to deliver the capacity to our network without having to upgrade the site. And if we think about our network is doubling in capacity, doubling in demand every 18 months. And that means that we need to deliver a whole new network's worth of capacity every 18 months, and that can't be at any cost. That brings me to the end of my presentation, and I look forward to receiving your questions. Thank you very much, and goodbye.